Mr. Wicker's Window by Carly Dawson, Chapter 11. From that time on, when Chris and Amos were inseparable, with the exception of those times when Chris studied alone with Mr. Wicker, Amos, during these hours, soon endeavored himself to Becky Boozer, to whom he became invaluable, for he took over those chores Chris has undertaken as his share. These consisted of carrying water, peeling potatoes, or watching the roasting meat in case it should burn. For Chris had less and less time for such jobs, and Amos's laughter and willing, happy nature soon made Becky spoil him as much as she did Chris. Another cot was put into Chris's room, and night after night they would hang out the two mansard windows, watching what all went on below until it was too dark to see, or else they would talk by the light of their candle until they fell asleep. Chris now knew how lonely he had been until he set Amos free from his wooden shroud, but warned by Mr. Wicker, he did not tell his new friend that he came from another year as yet unreached by the time they lived in. "It is enough for a while," cautioned Mr. Wicker, "that Amos get used to being limber and alive. That is change enough from a carved wooden finger. It would only confuse and trouble him to think you did not really belong where you are. So let him be happy. And I shall seal your lips with regard to the secret of the jewel tree, for that must be known to no one." And so saying, he rubbed a salve over Chris's lips. "Now tell me what you are to journey after," demanded Mr. Wicker, but when Chris attempted to talk of the jewel tree, the words would not pass his lips, but remained in his mouth like a handful of marbles. "Good," said Mr. Wicker, rubbing his hands. "Not even to me. Excellent stuff, this is," he added, turning to the tiny case that contained the salve in his fingers. "I got it in India years ago, and this is the last of it, but I hardly imagine I shall need it again. Its use is somewhat drastic, but occasionally wise." "Mr. Wicker," Chris said thoughtfully one afternoon after his lessons and memorizing were over for the day, "of the three things in your shop window that I like best, two have been unexplained. Yet the third, which still interests me, seemed as to have had, so far, no significance. I mean, of course, the rope."
"Ah, yes," Mr. Wicker agreed, nodding and stretching his feet out toward the fire. "The rope. Very well, my boy, since it has come into your mind again. That means that the time has come for you to discover its use. Go and bring it to me."
Chris ran to get the coiled rope. He experienced almost a shock when he touched it. It looked harsh and coarse to the touch, of raw of hemp fiber, but on picking it up, the coils in his hand seemed almost silky. Certainly they were more than usually pliable. Returning to the study, the boy put the rope beside Mr. Wicker's chair. The magician did not move, his feet still stretched comfortably toward the flames. His dark, handsome face was dreamy and remote, and Chris wondered in what faraway place or time his teacher moved. The apprentice sat down cross-legged with his back to the fire, and presently Mr. Wicker took his gaze from the sparks and smoke to look thoughtfully at him.
"You have heard of the Indian rope trick, Christopher?"
"Yes and no, sir," Chris replied. "I'm not sure how it works."
Mr. Wicker gave a chuckle.
"Indeed. Well, let me tell you, my boy, no one else does either. The rope is made to go up in the air so stiffly that the fakir, that is, the Eastern magician, can climb it. Some claim to have seen the fakirs climb up it and vanish from sight, and the rope disappear after them."
Mr. Wicker waved one hand, as much to say that those who had seen it could believe as they pleased.
"A good enough trick, in its way," consented Mr. Wicker. "But this rope is capable of so much more remarkable possibilities as to throw the Indian rope trick completely in the shade."
With one of his quick gestures, Mr. Wicker reached down the rope and was up and out of his chair, all in one movement.
"You shall learn, last of your lessons, a new way of using the lasso. Not lassoing."
Mr. Wicker held up a finger to stress his point.
"That, too, you shall learn, but how to use this particular rope to make the most of its, shall we say, qualities."
Mr. Wicker smiled a sardonic smile, though his eyes were snapping as brightly as the fire.
"Now, Christopher," he began, running the rope through his long, fine hands, "just push that table and the chairs at the wall. There's a good lad, and we shall get the stiffness out of this rope."
This cleared the room. "And pull the curtains, my boy," added Mr.'s master,
"for one never knows that but that Amos or Becky Boozer might pass by to the crucial moment."
"Well, they do not know," murmured Mr. Magician.
is best for them. When the room was satisfactorily arranged and the candles had been lit, Chris returned to stand by the fireplace beside his master, who was turning the rope lightly in his fingers. "Now, Christopher, your attention, please," demanded the magician, and his tone was crisp and authoritative. "Imagine that you are in need of a boat, and there is no boat." With several twists of his hand, the rope spun out into the middle air of the room. It moved and twisted like a live thing, and Mr. Wicker, Chris thought, seemed to be drawing the outline of a boat in the air with a moving line. Even at this thought that flickered in his mind, the rope moved, formed in midair, the skeleton of a dinghy. And then, mysteriously, the rope added to itself until the bare struts and sides were filled in and there, rocking lightly from the speed of its creation, a small rowboat hovered in the air as if it was tied up to a dock. "Go and feel of it, Christopher," Mr. Wicker urged. "Climb in it if you like. I've left the two ends of the rope long enough to make oars, if necessary." Chris ran over and felt the sides of the boat. It was sound and secure, no doubt of that. He went all around it, pounding its sides, and at last fumed himself over to fall into its center. The boat never stirred, and stamp as it would, the bottom and gunwales rested firmly. "Gee, Mr. Wicker," Lucid screamed. "This is the best yet, except for Amos. Golly Moses!" And as he sat down and took up the two loose ends of rope still remaining, he found that he held not rope ends, but two oars. "Even oars!" Chris cried in delight. Mr. Wicker stood with his hands behind his back, the firelight outlining his dark clothes and neat dark head. "Yes," he said in a matter-of-fact voice. "Quite so. Now climb out, and I will show you some of the other shapes of which it is capable." "A ladder," Mr. Wicker remarked as Chris rejoined him, "is almost too simple. We can do that at any time." Grasping the end of one oar, with movements too fast for Chris's eyes to follow, in an instant the boat was a rope again, coiled over Mr. Wicker's arm. "Now," said Mr. Wicker, and his eyes twinkled with mischief, the rope flew out again, but this time it took on a strange outline, the outline of an elephant. "It will have to be a small elephant," murmured Mr. Wicker, his hands flying, "because of the size of the room." The elephant, like the boat, took shape, the final ends of the rope hanging down at its shrunken tail. After the elephant came a horse, an eagle, and a dolphin, and Chris's admiration and zest to learn the secrets of the rope grew with every change of shape. "Very well," ended Mr. Wicker. "You shall learn." And placing his hands over Chris's while the boy held the rope, he began slowly to show him the magic twists and turns. Mr. Wicker's Window by Carly Dawson, Chapter 11, End.